Hello, everybody, and welcome to CAB, Covering All Bases, with Donnie Mack. Got a lot of things going on, but first of all, let me say this. I want to say thank you to our major sponsor, Wiggins Media Group Worldwide, WMGW, as our sponsor video platform host. This is a special edition, like a pop-up. I had said that earlier today. I am getting booked for the rest of the year, and then I have a lot of things that I would like to get in. So I used to do something called pop-up bookstores with a client of mine. This client that we have here today, or I guess, Miss Julia Royston. So that's kind of like spontaneous, okay? So I'm sorry if you didn't see a flyer. It's okay. We're still going to keep rolling, and we will not let anybody be lost in this conversation. I think that our subject matter is living your best life. Is that not correct, Ms. Royston?
That's right. That's correct.
So how about that? First, let me say this. I probably need this because after all of the come to Jesus moments that I've had over the last 2 or 3 years, I probably need to be sure about how I am living my life. Okay. So I will be taking note to this. So here we go. It is all yours, Miss Royston.
Well, hello, and thank you so much for allowing me to be on your platform. It is an honor and a privilege always when I'm giving opportunity on anyone's platform. So I don't take it lightly. I don't take it for granted. Again, I'm Julia Royston of BK Royston Publishing, Royal Media and Publishing, and the author community, the Book Business Bosses, where we help you get your message to the masses and turn your words into wealth. Super excited about also that I host a broadcast titled Live Your Best Life. And I am currently in the middle of writing my book that is accompanying that brand of Living Your Best Life. So what does living your best life mean? It means different things to different people. It means determining what you were put here on this earth to actually do. Why are you here? There is a reason, there is a purpose. You weren't just put on this earth to, as they say, breathe in and out and pay taxes and pay rent and pay bills. There is a reason for you to be here. Now, what that looks like for me and what that looks like for you are two different, totally different things. And I would be remiss and definitely wrong and erroneous if I tried to enforce or lay my things that are key to me living my best life on you. Now, if I'm doing something and that it resonates with you and you want to know how I do what I do, or you want me to coach you on how I do what I do, or a specific avenue of your life that I could possibly help and help you better it, sure. But to invoke my life on someone else's and the way I do everything is definitely wrong, because each of us has our own fingerprint, our own distinct look. You know, I may remind you of someone else. You know, your auntie or something might have laughed like me or done something, but there's only one me and there's only one of you. So striving to make sure that you're living your best life is really key. And that's what my program is, to help people live their best life. Now, it might be the old folks used to say, you eat the meat and you spit out the bones. So some weeks, sometimes it's like, oh, well, that was nice information, but it really doesn't apply to me. And then there are other times it really resonates with certain people. So the thing about it is take what you need, store what you don't think you need right now, because you never know, you may need it later.
Well, I just want to interject and try to make sure our audience has some clarity here. We are not talking about from a religious aspect.
No, and that's the reason why it's life, because the religious part of you is just one aspect of you. And I think, you know, we could have that discussion all day long, that, you know, the way I was raised, very fundamental, very Pentecostal, apostolic, the church was just basically a lot of what we did, but not in my parents' household. We had a full life, vacations, school, activities at school, education was key in our house. And we had that, what goes on in our house stays in our house, but it wasn't related to any kind of abuse or anything of that nature. It was always related to the advancement of our mind. And because there were three girls in the house, my father wanted to know that we would have sustainable skills to be able to have jobs and work no matter whether we were married or single. So that was, you know, number one in our house. So therefore having a full life of culture, music, the ballet, travel, international travel at that, was always a part of our lives. Now, some other people, it was not. It was very, you know, centered around just going to church and coming home, but our home was not. So it was, it's not, living your best life is not just your relationship with God, which should be having faith and being, and working your faith and being a faith-based human being is a part of your life, but there are some other aspects that he, you know, that he came to give you and that faith is related to, and not just going to church and not being in church. Of course, we can't do that right now anyway. You shouldn't, and it's very, to be safe. So therefore there's a virtual church. So if it's all about being in the building and having that type of relationship only there, it would be a moot point. So it's a whole life, a whole holistic life, all aspects of you.
Well, I follow you. I listen to a lot of people who really, when they speak about living a whole life, all of the things that you have said, they're not even close to that. Okay. A lot of the conversations that I get in, and you and I have discussed this, I think, at times, and you kind of know me, you know how I can, how flamboyant I can be in my opinions.
Sure.
I often say, golly, why do people live to die? And to me, that's, I really see that, you know, I'm looking at it. It's like, especially when we get a certain age, you know, say like from 60 on, I'm 69. I want to be here as long as I can. I want to live my life the way I want to live it, within reason. Okay. Right. I don't want to be worried about whether I'm going to heaven or hell.
No.
You can't function that way.
No. But I was raised that way, though. I was raised that way. That fear of going to hell was, I mean, you know, when I was 6 years old, I came to the altar and said I wanted to be baptized. And they said, well, why? And I said, because it wasn't, oh, I want to see Jesus. Oh, I love Jesus. And as a six-year-old, I said, I don't want to die and go to hell. And what six-year-old do you know says that if that was not implanted in you, embedded in you, about dying and going to hell? So I probably didn't really start to live that abundant life that I probably should have had at six going on until it was probably about 35, 38, 40 years old. And I realized that fear thing, that whole, oh my gosh, you know, why am I here? What am I here for? That knowing your significance. Then I started thinking about legacy. Then I started thinking about leaving my mark on this earth. Sure, death is a part of that, but you know, you want to leave something, some deposits right here on earth before you get to that point. I'm 57, you're 69. But even at 57, I know I could die because I've had family members who died before they were 40 and friends who died at 40. So therefore I realized, okay, I'm 57, girl, you need to get it done. Whatever you're going to get done, whatever's in your heart to do, whatever great dreams, goals, and visions that you have, let's get it done. But that's a mature thinking. That's a broad thinking. That's not a, you know, go to work, come home, work there 30 years, get up, go watch, and then retire and then die. And you've got to have had exposure to more things than just that. I mean, you've had to have been exposed or even have a hope for exposure for more than just that.
Well, I've been in Louisville for 30 years. And I often tell people that Louisville, let alone Kentucky, has saved my life. Being from Cincinnati originally, I lived a very, very fast life from the time I was 12 till the time I eventually left Cincinnati. Before I left Cincinnati, of course, in Cincinnati, music was my life. Music was my life. And people would really beg to differ with me, but believe me, even though I had two parents, both on their own business. My father had a hauling business, put in restaurant and refrigeration equipment. My mother was one of the top beauticians in the entire state of Ohio. But even before they start using the term, it was a dysfunctional family. And God knows I love both of my parents and they love me, okay? But, you know, I had to just constantly sort out things and learn things for myself, you know, in order to really keep my sanity at a young age, you know. I talk about it openly now. I talk about being abused, you know, by a woman, you know, a decade and a half older than me, you know. And of course, that confused me. Okay. All right. So now I get out of that situation without telling anybody about it until 30 years later. And in between that time, I'm still trying to sort things out, you know, with people. Hey, you're never going to be this. All you're going to keep doing is having babies. You know, why don't you do this? You can't get anywhere being a musician, yada, yada, yada. Okay. Then working with my dad, which was, it was educational for me, but he had no intentions of letting me take over that business and move on with his name and legacy on the line with his clients. So, you know, being a very defensive person, always willing at a moment to tell you to kiss my expletive, you know, and just wearing a chip on my shoulder, at some point in time, I had to start telling myself, this is not the way to live. This is not going to get me anywhere. Okay. So to really bring that part of the story to a close, crossing the river, getting over here, dating someone that I thought I was going to marry, who took all the rough edges off of me, she dies. Everybody's saying, well, now he's going back to Cincinnati. No, I don't have a life there in Cincinnati other than my kids. Even if I go back to my kids, what do I have to offer them? I have to stay in Kentucky and finish growing up. Mm-hmm. And when you said this was going to be our subject matter, I went back and looked at that. God, I would have never, despite my health issues, you know, and it hasn't always been great financially, but I've done more than just made it.
Right.
Down here.
Well, your biggest thing is that you're able to look in the mirror and say, you know, that old Frank Sinatra song, I did it my way, but I'm, you know, I feel good about myself, because that's the reason why I say it's got to be a maturity thing. You have to be, you know, it has to be a grown-up situation. And that's the reason why it has to be an individual affair, because I had to do the reverse. I did not want to leave Cincinnati. I love Cincinnati. I loved working for the biggest employer in the city. I enjoyed that. But, you know, it was time for me to come home. And yes, it was a spiritual direction and divine connection, but I didn't want to do it. I cried all the way across that bridge to come back home to Kentucky because I didn't want to. But it was the best thing for me long term.
Right.
Because I am able to be an entrepreneur, retire from a job, and now I can really, really live my best life on what I always say, bet on Black. So I'm betting on me, as opposed to asking for permission. What do you think? What do you think? And then, no, we don't have the funds for that. And no, it's on my terms. Succeed or fail, it's left up to me. So, you know, it is a maturity thing. It is a risk. You know, yours probably safest thing would have been to stay in Cincinnati. Mine too, you know, but it didn't work out that way. And it was a blow to me financially. It was a blow to my ego to have to come back home. And it wasn't like I was fired or anything like that. I put in my notice and I left and I packed my own boxes and I did as God commanded me. But long term, it has been a very good situation. And, you know, I still have a little few regrets. But overall, I'm glad I did.
I don't know if I have any regrets about staying here. Even though when I first moved down here, I was working for an entertainment company. And like I said, then the circumstances, you know, and it's not like I wasn't scared, but one of the things that I really did unknowingly was this young lady's family adopted me. And I really let them assimilate me. I had no idea of what they thought about me. Okay. And this is one of the things, like somebody like me, you know, who's coming to a place where you don't know anybody and you've only been here off and on for 3 years. And these people feel that they've gotten to know you and these people want to bring you in to their life. I tell everybody, when you make a move like this, you have to establish surrogacy. Is that such a word?
Yeah.
I mean, you have to establish that with the church family, neighborhood family. You got a great husband, even though, you know, he's not from Jeffersonville, he's from Kentucky. But hey, you know, I mean, you reestablished yourself with some good things coming back. I've done that. I've been a record promoter. How I got into record promotions, and I've told you this, I have no clue. But that saved me. That would have never happened for me in Cincinnati.
Uh-huh.
I would have never traveled all across the country and be able to meet the people that I have met had I stayed in Cincinnati.
Right.
You know, even though that business literally almost killed me.
Right.
You know, and I'm still damaged from it. But, you know, the OGs got to keep it rolling.
We got to keep it rolling. Old folks, we got to keep it rolling. But one of the keys is that, you know, that scripture of we walk by faith and not by sight is really key. It's really a real thing. Because when I did come back home and took it's about a $30,000 pay cut. But there were opportunities that happened to me that basically, you know, I didn't have the money. So it wasn't like, you know, I was trying to raise it. It was done for me. So a free education, you know, all of that was afforded me, but I had to be in the right place at the right time. And I went to Jamaica 4 times on mission trips and establish a library there and, you know, just all kinds of things and exposure to doing different things, teaching online for the first time, teaching different people and, you know, just teaching on a different level. And so opportunity, that door did not open until I walked through it. Now, financially, sure, I would have loved to have made that money I made in Cincinnati. But it was a time for me to, you know, just like you go to college, and you know, you got, as they always say, broke college students. It was a time for me to learn. It was a time for me to be exposed to different people, different places, different things. I received a prophecy that I was going to the nations, but I had no idea that I'd probably be going to the nations sitting right here at my desk. I might not be physically going there, but I may be going there virtually. But you have to be prepared for that. You have to widen and broaden your horizons. You cannot just stay. Sure, you always need family and friends and people that you are familiar with. You can't stay in that circle. You have to broaden your horizons. You have to learn from different cultures, different people, be exposed to different foods and different lifestyles, and realize that. And I've been embarrassed quite a few times because you make assumptions, you make prejudices that's not based on race, but some of it is based on religion. Some of it is based on faith, or erroneous information that you've been taught, that you assumed because you were taught that was true and it wasn't true. So there are a lot of prejudices out there. It's just not a race prejudice. It's class, it's faith, it's access to people, places, and things. There's just so many different things. And for you to be able to assimilate to and connect to people of different cultures, faith, creeds, ethnicities, and sometimes sexual orientation requires that you be grown up and that you expand and that you respect other people's abilities, talents, and gifts, but you also respect their differences. And you don't have to just sit there and be totally disagreeable. You can find that middle ground that we can discuss and maybe all the time disagree. But having that respect level for other people helps broaden your horizons if you're able to see someone else's side and see somebody else's point, even if you don't agree with it. Doesn't require that you agree with it. It's just that you be broad and open-minded enough to hear what somebody else has to say.
Well, you said a key word about 50 words ago. Culture. As you know, I'm a foster grandparent in the school system. Who would have ever thought, you know, I start out with elementary school kids, and that was a come to Jesus moment, because as you know, one of them almost killed me with the virus. Mm-hmm. I get out of that and I go to where I wanted to go in the beginning, which was to a performing arts school. You know, I get there, and now everything that you said came into play in culture. First and foremost, sexual orientation. That was right in front of me. All of my kids were not American. They were Latino, they were Muslim. They were from any part of Europe or over in Asia that you could name. You got all of this in front of you. So, man, I'm here, now what? I love the kids. I went to U of L and took a audited class, music movement in early childhood, to deal with all of that, because the music is the best communications network in the world. I don't care what you say.
It's the universal language, isn't
it? That's just it. Yeah, okay.
The universal language.
You can't laugh at the structure of any other culture's definement of what they love or determine as music. You just can't do it. So first thing was language barriers. I got Latino kids. So it makes you think. So I go in my phone and I put about 50 one-liners, Spanish one-liners in my phone so I could communicate with my Latino kids. And I was doing good, but even that was a challenge because they're 5 years old. They're still developing their language. They don't know what I'm saying, you know? So the culture of things, no matter what it is, from sexual orientation to your ethnicity.
Uh-huh.
Okay. I mean, if you are not dealing with that as you go along, especially the longer you live, you're going to be in trouble.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care who you are.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because you're not going to understand. There's no such thing, like at my age, as not being able to understand anything be acceptable. Mm-hmm. Living your best life. I'm still doing that. I had a cousin that just passed that you know. My sister, I call her on Saturdays. What you doing? Getting ready to go to a funeral. Okay, I'll call you next Saturday. I call her. What you doing? Getting ready to go to a funeral. And every Saturday, this went on and on and on and on. And I'm like, man, is this all you have to do on Saturdays is go to a funeral? Well, they're expecting me there to sing. So on Saturday, this past Saturday, I'm at her funeral. Come on now. Sometimes I think we have to be selfish about ourselves. I get criticized all the time for being self-centered. And it got so bad, I would have to go ask people, am I really like that? Well, no, Don, you're not like that. You're not self-centered. You just like your life and you like to live and you're smart. Okay, I'm smart. If I am, I'm damn sure, oh boy, they're gonna censor me. not ashamed to be smart.
Well, I mean, it's self-preservation more than just being selfish, you know. And of course, you're a man, but as a woman, we have to fight even harder of taking care of other people, taking care of our parents, taking care of kids, taking care of husbands.
I did all of it.
Whatever. Yeah, you've done that too. But yeah. Women, we are really expected to do that even more so. So that self-care idea that you're talking about is even more stressful for us because, you know, it's not like, okay, Black girl magic and I'm all that and I can bring up the bacon and fry it up in a pan and I can do it. No, you're not Superwoman. Sorry, baby, go sit down. You will have to take a rest. You will have to go get your nails done sometimes. And sometimes you will have to pay a babysitter to watch your kids while you get a massage. I mean, it just will happen or you'll break down very quickly. So, you know, it's more self-care and self-preservation, even more than sickness. I mean, more than being selfish, I'm sorry. More than being selfish. It's an idea of, I want to live. And so I have to do the same things before I do certain events. I may have to take a 2-hour nap. Now, fortunately, I work from home and I'm an entrepreneur, so I can do that because I realize I'm sleepy. I was up at 3:00 in the morning. I was up at 4:00. I was writing. I got involved in something and then I'm sleepy at 2:00 in the afternoon. So I can take an hour and a half, 2-hour nap and take care of myself because it is my body. Because what'll happen is one day, if I don't take care of myself, somebody will be coming to my funeral saying, oh, wow, she did some great things, but now she's dead. Okay, next, what are we going to eat after this? I mean, that is just life. That's exactly the way life is. I mean, you know, so if you don't take care of yourself, who will? If
yeah, because when you're gone, your space, you're gone.
Who will? Yeah.
Yeah, when you're gone, you're gone. And
yeah, you're gone, you're gone.
I don't have to tell you how close I was to this cousin. She's gone.
Mm-hmm.
I'm hurting, but she's gone. And she was one of my biggest supporters.
Mm-hmm.
Had an appreciation of everything that I did, that I was trying to do, that I did in the past. She followed me. So now the big question is, you living your life, mm-hmm. and I spoke about your marriage. You have a great marriage. You know, I know the both of you. Okay, I know he knows what lines not to cross. I know that you know what lines not to cross.
Oh yeah, you told him what lines not to cross. You told him what lines
not to cross. Oh, come on now. But we have to talk about the books.
Oh yeah.
We have to talk about you being, you know how I am about what you are. You are a real publisher and not fly by night. No. You are a real author and a not fly by night author.
Right. Yes.
Okay. You listen. You listen to me on a couple things. I mean, you, hey, we tried a couple things and they should have worked had the tribe gone along with it.
Well, I think it worked as well as it could. And you're right that, you know, some people are not ready for certain things as they you think they should. But
go ahead and bail them out because I'm
hey, but that's their life. I mean, you know, my job is to create opportunities. If you take them, fine. If you don't, I'll right. keep moving and I'll find tribes that will. And that's what I did. So we had the idea. So first off, BK Royston Publishing and Royal Media and Publishing are full service publishing companies. So I say that I help you get the, which I have done several times, help you get your book from your idea out of your head onto Amazon and beyond. So that's what we do. It gives us the opportunity. I've done it for 12 years, headed into in 2021, it'll be headed into my 13th year. I published more than 300 books. I have written 50. Books is what I know. I have two master's degrees in library science. So libraries and books is just kind of what I do. And but honestly, I have to say that in 2020, people have really understood that, oh my gosh, I haven't got my book done. I've been writing on this thing for the longest. So they have made a great deal of headway in writing their story. Now, to Donnie's point, he came up with the idea to me and my husband about having book fairs and malls and all of that. And there were very few of the authors that were already signed to my camp that could see the vision. But I realized now that we only had a year and a half to do it. We didn't have, because now the malls and the malls company I was associated with just filed Chapter 11, I think I saw, sent you that article. So therefore, we had a window of opportunity to do that. And if I said I'll wait to 2020 to do it and didn't start it in 2018, we wouldn't be able to do it. We would probably lost money because now everything is so uncertain. So I really encourage you, if there's something that you desire to do, you have a dream, goal, and a vision, and it's not illegal, and it's not immoral, and it's not unethical, go for it. If it is something that has been a dream, it's something that you're passionate about and something you've always wanted to do, you need to strive for it. Now, I probably invested more money than my husband would have liked for me to invest, but I can truthfully say that in that 18-month period, you know, I built relationships across the country with, you know, major malls in the country. And so therefore, if I ever wanted to go back and do that again, I could. If I ever came back to that area, I have authors now that are in that area. So we planted seeds and I'm grateful for that. But after that, you know, it might have been a one and done season. It wasn't just one mall, because, you know, one mall in Louisville we multiple times, but it's just a point of people were going to see it, and they did. They came to the mall and they were like, oh, is this what you were talking about? We did a pop-up bookstore in December of 2019. And like, oh, okay, so you're going to do it next year? There's no next year. 2020, no, everything shut down. You can't do it. That those malls may be even closed. You know, COVID hit. That was our one and done to do it. So, you know, I have the pictures to prove it. Every one of my book fairs, I have documentation. I've done it, been there, done that. But I didn't wait. I had that opportunity. And, you know, even the one book fair we did in Hopkinsville, the store closed. So it's no longer there. So yeah. Therefore, you know, there are a lot of opportunities that we had, but we have to take an advantage of those opportunities right away, because otherwise it's a new season, it's a new day. And I even have people now that I'm in the virtual, I'm doing virtual book fairs, and there's still people who, oh no, I'll wait till we are able to do book sign-ins in person and we can go back to the major bookstore retailers, and we're going to have events and big tables, and that'll happen next year. Will it? I don't know. So therefore 2020 has been committed to doing it in the virtual space, the Zoom space, the StreamYard space, the Facebook Live, YouTube Live, Periscope space. So we've been in all of those platforms seeking to expand knowledge about books, because going into bookstores is not necessarily safe or feasible or even open to be able to do that. Having the ability to have your books on an online store and then have inventory from your house and ship them out is the safest place and the safest way.
Well, I'm glad the pop-up thing stayed in my mind, because having launched this podcast last week, and I, of all people, should know, visibility is all of that. Okay. And I don't have to tell you how hesitant I was and how nervous I was. And like my sponsor would say, come on, man, you got to be kidding me. You know, everybody, you know, you can find anybody.
It's a different place and it's a different space. And when you're pulling yourself out of your comfort zone, you know, you're used to walking up to it and blinking your eyes, because I know them eyes you got, and blinking your eyes at the gatekeepers, and they just give you.
Oh, come on now, come on now.
No, I know that, but it's your voice. It's being heard audibly, and audio, and you're having to jump out into deep waters, new waters, and we all have to do it. This whole year has taught us anything, that we have to go into new places, do things differently than we've ever had to do before, so yeah. That we can continue to move our messages forward and move our businesses and our lives forward, so that we can live the best life that we were equipped to live. There's knowledge in us. There's experience in us. There are people who have the question and we have the answer. And if we're not in that space where they are with the question, they can't get the answer. Sure, they could Google it. They could YouTube it and find it. But some people are different and they won't do that search on their own. So therefore, we got to be in these spaces.
Well, I have to prepare you. Okay, I really have to prepare you for this. I'm rolling now. I mean, the Wiggins Media Group worldwide are trying to put a choker chain on me now.
What's that be? A choker chain? No.
They try to put a choker chain on me.
Turn you loose. Turn Donnie Mac loose.
Man, hold up. So what's coming up is the Cab Cafe.
Oh, okay. That's great.
It'll probably launch next year.
Okay.
I've already got some great artists. Oh, man, I'm just... And WMGW is saying, hey, man, that's great, you know, but where are we going to fit it? Hey, we're going to fit it right at 2021, January. Have it
rolled. Sounds good. And the artists are going to love you for it, because I have really prayed for the artists more than anything. That, well, and of course, the hairstylists and all those people too. But the artists have really been hit really, really hard.
Well, but you know, I designed Cab for them to begin with, covering all bases as a workshop. You know, hey, you have to know this, you have to know that, you have to know everything that you don't know.
Right.
You but have
they
to
need
find
a platform now. Now they right. need a platform to be heard, and you're going to give them that. I think that's phenomenal.
Yeah. Oh, well, thank you. But, you know, I designed it for the music industry to begin with, and it's still. Its primary focus is still the arts. Like, I'm going to have Harold Uwe Kern, who is the director of the Louisville Ballet. And what's really exciting to me about that is his attitude about not enough minorities in ballet. Mm-hmm. You know, he's from Belgium. He's from over there where they have to put their thumbs in the hole in the dams to keep the water from coming through. Mm-hmm. And they know very, very little color racism. Mm-hmm. They've got racism over there, but it don't have nothing to do with color.
Right.
And, you know, I don't want to give too much of it away, and I probably better be quiet because, but, you know, I'm excited about having him on here with the arts. I'll have theater on here. I'll have you singing, of course.
Yeah. Give me till March and I'll be ready.
So I was able to throw that in and I was going to rush, but I see we got a little bit of time left and you and I could probably do this all night, but we'll have to schedule another time. But
sure.
While we're on here, I just, you know, got some things coming up, if you don't mind. Next week, I'm going to have Judge Tracy Hunter out of Cincinnati. I'm really excited about that. I have to say this. She said that we could say what we needed to say. And if you don't know who Judge Tracy Hunter is, they drug her out of the courtroom. And to me, that was like a slave being sold, taken away from their family. Mm-hmm. Just dragging her out like that. It's got to be traumatizing. So she's going to come on and just tell her story on the 18th. So, you know, all that information to be out. So we got a lot of people coming up. You'll be back. You know, you're my family, you know. And when I said, pop up, hey. And, you know, people respond to me saying, you know, well, what is this about? It's pop up. Check in and see. And you know I will say that. And I did. I mean, why do you think they call it pop-up? It's pop-up.
Yeah.
Everything goes. Well, not in your case.
No.
But sooner or later, I will do a pop-up and everything will go.
Yeah.
And bam.
Yeah, and make it happen.
So, Ms. Royston, I have thoroughly enjoyed this.
Sure. Thank you.
And again, I want to thank the Wiggins Media Group Worldwide for this platform. And they're loosening up the choker chain on me.
Are they loosening it up?
Oh, they loosening it up, you know. Well, especially when I said the Cab Cafe, they're ready to roll.
Oh yeah, I'm quite sure they love it.
when I said the Cab Cafe, you know, that man.
That's gonna be good.
We knew that you can do it.
Yeah, that's gonna be good.
My first guest is gonna be a young lady that's just the bomb. Just the bomb. Jazz saxophonist.
Oh, that's gonna be nice.
She responded to me right away. I saw her. I'm like, hey, come on now.
That's gonna be great.
Let's roll with this. And she responded to me in less than 24 hours.
Oh,
I would love to be on the Covering All Bases video platform. You in?
Oh, that's wonderful.
Ms. Royston, great. I love you.
Love you too.
Say hi to the hubby.
I will.
And of course, you know what to do with this after we get disconnected.
Yes, sir. I will. You be blessed.
And thank you for saving me.
Yeah, but that's all right.
No, okay, I'm getting better at this, you know. You know, last week I knocked down my backdrop.
That happens. I've done that too. As you go, I took my backdrop down and my cousin came up for a weekend. Took care of my whole office so I could have a set. So yeah, it happens.
So everybody will be mad at me tomorrow. What happened? Well, hey, crap happens.